We often hear about these tensions in our day-to-day around taking or accepting things at face value. Some of us hope we can see beyond taken-for-granted understandings of our experiences, or what we witness. We all see things from our own unique perspectives, and of course, like everything, this can have consequences beyond our scopes. I've been thinking a lot lately about the power of representation and what this concept of face value means today in Canada. Canadian identity, or how Canadians are represented, is complex. As a white Canadian myself, I'm invited to relate to a selection of identity-strengthening stories. These stories are connected to a set of shared values which reaffirm who and what Canada is. Sometimes stories are represented by symbols or images and in very complex ways indicate to us who we celebrate and who we don't. These stories are personal and they are embedded in our history. Many of us get defensive if these stories are threatened. Is taking things at face value an innocent thing? Or is it simply to have some control over our own identities, especially in cases where our identities are validated and glorified? Seeing things at face value is a kind of denial. It's a kind of silencing. So what happens when we only validate stories that produce or reproduce our official Canadian identities without thinking beyond face value? Mader and Joseph point out that the discourses at work within a voice, narrative, or report often reproduce, reinforce, or activate socially constituted ideas. This reliance on taking things at face value, without attention to analysis and power, reaffirms the Canadian project, making it dominant and superior to Indigenous and other colonized and subordinated people. It stops us from asking important questions. According to Johnstone in her 2018 article, Canadian national identity continues to be deeply entwined in the idea that Canada is and was a vast unoccupied northern wilderness. Because we find ourselves in an era of reconciliation, and through counter-storytelling, we know this is not true. We can also make the connection that the myth around the completion of the Canadian settlement project is also part of our Canadian national identity. Johnstone also borrows from Indigenous scholar Benita Lawrence, who in 2002 observed that in order to sustain this myth, the official history of Canada has long omitted the settler history of erasure. She states the silencing of Native people in national discourses ensures this myth is perpetuated. June Yee builds on Shireen Razick, pointing to how nationalist discourses deny ongoing colonization. Through state mechanisms like multiculturalism, and I would add other programming like immigration, labor, and even reconciliation, social workers complete nation-building tasks through the lens of helping every day. These tasks require, according to Johnstone, a gatekeeping function. Gatekeeping maintains not only a certain kind of narrative, but also determines who Canadians are and who they are not. These institutions shape how we understand our roles working in an era of reconciliation. As social work leaders, we need to be thinking about how our roles as social workers constitute Canadian nation building through colonial gatekeeping. Social work's foundation and how it is enacted every day as a nation building project contradicts decolonizing principles. So can social work's role in reconciliation go beyond face value? Yee points to white supremacy in institutions, directly linking the significant role early social work plays in embedding white supremacist values in the method, system, and practices of the social work profession as we know it today. White people determine and control the norms and values of Canada. It is accomplished through the strategies and processes of whiteness that are presented to all as fair, neutral, and value-free. For Yee, one cannot expect to address white supremacy if they're unable to realize how seemingly innocent practices of helping, in fact, produce and reproduce colonial relations of domination. In other words, if Canadian social workers fail to reflect on how their Canadian national identities and nationalist pride affect their roles in maintaining and shaping today's Canada, they simultaneously delegitimize, diminish, and even invisibilize current Indigenous decolonization efforts. Leadership means going beyond face value, interrogating your role and questioning its authenticity. This means that I am subject to complex systems of power, and going beyond face value is engaging an awareness of the Canadian state's colonizing motives in my own social work practice. If we don't question beyond Canadian reconciliation discourse, we are complicit in the colonial white supremacist myths that dominate Canadian media and mainstream ideologies. For the benefit of Canadians like myself, corporations, and Canada and its expansion, at the expense of Indigenous land repatriation and self-determination.